Hi, everybody. Welcome to Baltimore Comic-Con Live, not at Baltimore Comic-Con, which I miss desperately. Thank you so much for joining us. I am Christy Blanch, and out of Indiana, All Yeah Comics, and I appreciate you all joining us. I'm going to go ahead and introduce the guest, because that's who we're all here to see, including me. The amazing legend, Louise Simonson.
Hi, Christy. How are you?
I'm good, Wheezy. How are you?
You're amazing, too.
You're amazing. I miss seeing you. Oh, my gosh.
I know. Well, eventually, we'll all have vaccines, and, you know, maybe in a year or so, we'll see each other again.
I sure hope so, because it's getting old.
It is, isn't it?
So, welcome. You've been keeping busy. I keep up with you on Facebook. So, this is all about you, this whole panel, because we're not even going to be able to cover everything because, I mean, please, it's you. But I just kind of want to go through your career so people understand how it's, when people say, you know, women haven't been in comics, I'm like,
yeah, I know.
Louise?
and a batch of other people too, I have to say. So.
Oh yeah, and a lot of other people. And so it you know, June, and there's so, Trina, so many people. But I kind of wanted to start with, I'm going to brag a little bit because I have this.
Oh God. That's ancient history there, right?
It is so beautiful. I can't even believe it's like I'm touching it. Well, I'm touching the outside of it.
Yeah.
Anyway. Yeah. First appearance of Swamp Thing, Bernie Wrightson, amazing artist. That was in 1971.
Wow.
And how did that happen?
I was living in New York City. Mm-hmm. I was working for a magazine publisher, advertising promotion, but I knew a batch of people. I was married to Jeff Jones at that time. And I knew about a lot of people, I guess three or four people maybe lived in our building, including Bernie. Bernie and I don't know if Mike Kaluta was in the building or not. I think Alan Weiss was around there somewhere. So it was like a small community of comics people. I mean, Archie Goodwin was a couple of blocks down the road. You know, we sort of hung out together. So the guys, for some reason, got it into their head suddenly it was a good idea to use reference, right? Mm-hmm. Which, of course, I mean, Bernie, you know, he's, by the time Bernie is done with a reference, it doesn't necessarily resemble what the photographs were. But so they decided this particular story of Bernie's, they decided Bernie and his and Kaluta and decided that they were going to photograph it, that Bernie was going to be the hero and Kaluta was going to be the villain and I was going to be the beautiful female in distress. So so we got together and I think Jeff was taking the photographs and we acted it out. I'm there on the cover, which is what they're going to put. They're going to post that on my gravestone. When I get, that will be it. Yeah, let's see. Yeah, she wrote some stuff too. You know, who knew? It was just fun. I mean, if you look at the story inside, you'll see Bernie being the hero and Michael being the villain. You know, the mustache and stuff was fun. Yeah, we had a good time. There were several. Several stories that we did, that we, I don't know, put on costumes and acted out. But I don't even know what the other story was. I remember, I think it was some sort of fantasy thing because I had a pillow tied to the top of my head for a hat with a scarf around my, you know, to tie it onto my neck. That was that story. I mean, I was just at the right place at the right time. You know, it's all, well, a lot of life is who you know.
Yeah, yes, and timing, and it was perfect. At the time, did you have interest in writing comics?
Never occurred to me to write comics. I liked comics. I liked particularly the work, oddly enough, of Archie Goodwin. And, you know, I was familiar with that before I met Archie, even because of the Warren books. I particularly liked Archie's Blazing Combat.
Oh, yeah.
Stories, which is odd because I don't even like war comics, but it was really an anti-war comics what he was doing. And it was pretty cool. So, but it never occurred to me to do it myself. I ended up, I was over in magazine publishing and I liked that. And then I ended up working at Warren because of who I knew. I had a friend who worked there. And she said, there's an opening at our office and they pay better than your job. So why don't you apply? And I thought, oh, wow, you know, the Warren books, I like the Warren books. They're really pretty cool. So I went, I applied and I got the job in production, which is, you know, paste up some mechanicals and art corrections and, you know, I don't know, running the photostat machine and a lot of stuff. And I was okay at production, not the most brilliant at production. Oh, paste up some mechanicals, I could do those too, sort of. But I wasn't brilliant at it. However, it was a very small company and they always needed hands to do other things. Mm-hmm. Somebody to write advertising copy and I'd say, I can do that, or letters, I can write letters pages, I can do this, I can do that. So finally they just moved me over into editorial. And, you know, created an assistant editor position for me. And I.
Things like that.
There I am. Yep.
And Erie.
Yep.
Yep. These are all.
Those are all ours. Creepy Erie and Vampirella.
They are all, those are all you. We had a couple comments, people just saying how you're amazing.
Sure.
I agree with. And hey, Josh Hand, thank you. It's one of my customers who just goes on and on about you because.
Hi, Josh.
So that was there. You stayed there until 1979, and then you went to Marvel. So how did you get the attention of Marvel, or how did you decide to go there?
I expect it was partly who I knew. Again, no, network people, network. I had been the senior editor at Warren for about 4 years. And I actually I'd worked with a lot of American freelancers, which was unusual for Warren. I think I brought in, you know, more people than had been there before. So I knew those folks. And at that point, I was dating Walter. my adorable husband. And
hi, Walter, if you're around.
I don't think he's watching. I don't blame him. Blah blah, he hears me talking all the time. And then we played volleyball.
Okay.
With the Marvel guys, the Marvel crew. Volleyball was played fanatically at Marvel for ages. I believe when that started, I was not working at Marvel, but I would come over and play volleyball with the Marvel guys. Mm-hmm. And Shooter called me up and asked me, you know, did I want to go out to dinner and talk about maybe working there? I assume he was familiar with my work, but I also think that I seemed probably maybe okay or less scary or like I would fit in because I played volleyball with the crew. I do not know why any of this stuff happens. I had been asked several times by Jeanette Kahn to come work at DC, mm-hmm. but I didn't really want to leave Warren at that point. I liked being where I was. I felt like I was learning a lot of stuff just by doing it. And when Shooter called at the right time, when I really felt like I wanted a larger, because I wanted to swim in a larger pond. And also I could see that Jim Warren's, my boss's interest in publishing was waning and that his interests were moving elsewhere.
Okay.
So I thought, you know what, maybe it's time to just, you know, go on to something else. So I went over and worked at Marvel. Honestly, the fact that I had played volleyball with a lot of the Marvel guys probably made it more comfortable for me to move there too, because I wasn't moving into something that was entirely strange. One of the other editors, in fact, Al Milgram, just lived down the street from us also. So, that and Archie did and all. So it was like just, coming home in a way.
Yeah. It was just going to somebody else's house for a while.
Yes, exactly. Work and have fun.
And at that point, you're still editing.
Yes.
So you're doing X-Men and New Mutants, which you have a cameo in.
I do.
Issues. 21. Star Wars, Indiana Jones, all of these.
The licensed books, right? I had Chris in the licensed books.
Yes. So when did you get the urge to write?
When Shooter hired a batch of new, or several new editors, and our workload was cut in half.
Okay.
I was perfectly fine with the workload I had. I wasn't overstressed by it. And when my workload was cut, I actually was a little bit bored. Mm-hmm. Also, Shooter had been after his editors to do freelance work because I think it was because he wanted us to see what it was like on the other side of the desk. To work as a freelancer, working for someone else, and to kind of, see what their editorial style were. You can learn a lot that way too. So I didn't want to take work away from any of the people. I knew the writers who, I could color a little bit, but I wasn't a fabulous colorist. And I could write, I thought, maybe. I didn't want to take a work away from any of the writers that I knew because they supported their families by writing. And I just felt guilty to be, because I had a job. Mm-hmm. But I thought, well, if I make up something new, then maybe it's like I'm adding to the pile instead of subtracting.
Yes.
So I came up with this idea for Power Pack, which was, four little kids who were superheroes. Mm-hmm. And I went into Shooter and I said, so I have this idea. And he said, well, kind of rolled his eyes, four little kids who were superheroes. I said, well, write up something and we'll see. Maybe we can turn it into a miniseries. Very little hope in his voice.
Yeah.
And I said, okay. So I wrote up character designs, character crises. A first plot was really tight. And then a second, third, and fourth plot. Because I thought it was going to be a miniseries, four issues, right?
Yeah.
And and then June Brinkman came into my office looking for work. And I all of my books were filled. I didn't have room for her, but I really liked what she was doing. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, can you draw kids? And she said, oh yeah. She had worked at Six Flags doing one of those sketch artist people.
Yeah.
And it was great. And I said, okay, well look, take this home, draw the kids, gave her my write up, draw the kids and bring them back. And if what you've got is pretty much what's in my head, as one does, then I'll suggest us as a team. So she came back with these wonderful little drawings and I, stapled them into the content and put them in a folder and handed them to Shooter. And a couple of days later, Shooter came back and said, this is great. I've seen treatments for screenplays that are for movies that are not as good as this. Why, you've got a series. The first issue is a double-sized issue and it's due in 2 months.
No pressure.
June hasn't drawn a comic before.
Oh, and wow.
I hadn't written a comic before.
Okay.
So we did. I mean, it worked out, I mean, June's work was so original. The fact that she could draw kids so well. Mm-hmm. And the idea, I think, of the kids superheroes was unusual too. So we actually got really good reviews on it and it sold pretty well. So, then after that I saw what fun it was being a writer, mm-hmm. particularly when you have an artist who you're very compatible with. Oh yeah, there you are. Hi, June.
Yeah, I These are, I just happen to have these.
Why wouldn't you? And access to any other number of comics, I expect.
Oh my goodness, yeah. Yeah, quite a few. So, but what pushed you to create this story, the Power Pack? I mean, what was your inspiration for it? When did you get that, like, aha?
You know, I never know why I do anything. It's really probably a deficit in my character, but I just got the idea. I mean, Archie Goodwin's idea, how do you get your ideas? And Archie Goodwin's story was, or a little comic strip actually, where this is how I get my ideas. And he puts he's got this drawing of his head resting on his hands, you know, sitting in front of a keyboard. Mm-hmm. And he says, for the really hard ideas, I use two hands. that's really kind of how it is. I've always liked kids' books. Mm-hmm. I knew that there were kids who read the Marvel books, who didn't see themselves in the Marvel universe. And I thought maybe it would be fun for them to see themselves. But this is all analysis after the fact. I chose four kids because my family, we have four kids in my family. I mean, we're all girls, we're my three sisters. But four seemed the right number because you could have, you know, teams of two, you can have three ganging up on one. It yep. gives you a lot of flexibility for character development and conflict and resolution.
Yes, exactly.
One of my favorite books had four kids. When I was a kid, the Half Magic books had four kids, and Little Women had four kids. So, you know, the Narnia book had four kids, I think. So, or was it five? Who can remember? At any rate, four seemed the right number. So that's what I did. You know, two boys and two girls, because I figured, you know, give everybody somebody that looks like them more or less.
Yeah.
Duh.
Yeah, that's awesome. So you've got Power Pack. You wrote almost all of the issues of it.
I wrote up to, I think it was past issue 50. Gosh, I can't remember. You know, I can never remember how many issues of anything I wrote at any given time. I wrote a batch of them. It was certainly up into the 40s. I don't know if I wrote issue 50 or not. At that point, we had, you know, I was doing New Mutants, mm-hmm. and I was doing X-Factor, and we were working toward, and we had done Mutant Massacre, and then, what was the next one? Fall of the Mutants, and we were building toward Inferno. Mm-hmm. It was more work than I could handle and do a good job. It seemed to me back when I was writing things regularly, I could write two books a month really well. And I could write three books a month, and the third one wasn't as sharp as it could have been. It was, you know, it's just maybe the way my mind worked. Mm-hmm. So I got off John McDonough, who was my artist on Power Pack at the time, he had a great ideas, and he knew he could draw. He drew kids really well, and he seemed to really, he identified very much with the Power Pack characters. So I got off the book and let him write it for a while I did New Mutants and Inferno and, you know, God knows what else. I think another Exterminators, I think. So that's the reason that I got off. Also, I think John couldn't draw necessarily all of the issues, and they kept giving me fill-ins, and the fill-ins had, you know, the artists were fine, but the kids didn't look like themselves. Mm-hmm. This is really strange, and I began to feel like the dialogue that I was writing for those books weren't, like I was writing imposters, like my dialogue was imposter dialogue.
Okay.
You know, perfectly serviceable, but it didn't feel right to me. So also, I just felt like it was doing a disservice to the book. I wasn't doing it properly and should just get off and let somebody else do it. So that was my the story of why we got off Power Pack.
And you even colored one issue.
Did I?
Yeah, you did.
Oh, Lord, I don't even remember doing that. You know, I could color stuff. It must have been in a pinch. There must have been some reason for it. Like, you know, I don't, it fell between the cracks of coloring or the colorist got sick or something. That's weird. I wonder what issue it was. I'll have to look that up.
I think it was 18.
18? I'm not even sure which one that was, but I'll have to look and see.
That's your homework. No.
Yes, it is.
So you did all sorts of things. You did Star Years. You did Marvel team-ups. You did Web of Spider-Man. You did Red Sonja. And then you were asked to fill in on X Factor. And you wrote a script, but it was never published. Is that correct?
Right. Well, it was actually a plot, because we were working for a plot at the point. Okay. But there's a lot of dialogue in there. And I was asked to do it because I think Bob Layton was the writer on that book. Mm-hmm. And he was really running really late. And Bob Harris was the editor, asked me to do a fill-in. And I had problems with some of the developments in that book. You know, it really aggravated me that here Scott was, you know, completely blithely not telling Jean anything about being married or any of that stuff. I mean, there was like all sorts of, I was just irritated by the social interactions.
Yeah.
So I wrote a plot in which Scott kind of lost it because it was building up so much for him. And, you know, it was like one of these soap opera plots, but yeah, with a lot of action, of course, because I do that. But and that one, and then Bob Layton came through with his story. So his story ran, I think it was going to be issue number four or five. I can't even remember now which issue it would have been. But I guess Layton was getting off the book. And they asked me, because they had liked the soap opera, my soap opera story, they had asked me to come on and write X Factor after that. So I came on and I was able to work Scott kind of losing it into one of the stories that I did. So that was good. And I was able I found it strange, a strange development. It's like, my question for the whole formation was, why in the world would a group of heroes pretend to be mutant hunters? And then you've got this guy named Cameron Hodge, who's supposedly running the thing, who is, you know, denigrating mutants, even as, you know, they're out there supposedly going to capture these people, we're actually saving them, rescuing them, training them. And I thought, this is crazy. What kind of person would do that? And I said, well, obviously he's a villain.
Yeah.
So, you know, he is a nefarious being. So I, you know, we made a lot of hay out of that story for a while. We finally straightened out the whole Madeline Pryor, Jean Grey conundrum.
Yeah.
That took a lot of issues. I mean, that was, you know, that took all the way through Inferno before we got that straightened out.
That run was so good. You created a character called Apocalypse.
I did.
Yes.
So yeah, I know. I thought X Factor needed a major bad guy other than Hodge. I mean, Hodge is a suit bad guy.
Yeah.
I mean, he's got a big organization behind him, but he's, he's Lex Luthor. I mean, he's, you know, but I wanted a superhero bad guy. And so I came up with Apocalypse. God knows why. I think I liked the idea of someone who was using bad means to get to what he saw as a positive end. Mm-hmm. The Apocalypse had seen the future. He was a shapeshifter who was virtually immortal, mm-hmm. Very technologically advanced, and had a need to make humanity stronger, so that when the Celestials, I didn't reveal that until like ages and ages later, He had taken a device from the Celestials, which he eventually was able to, because he lived, he was immortal. He was able to turn into his ship, and he knew the Celestials were going to come back using this device, this ship, as a it was recording the human progress, and he tried to gain control of it, which he did more or less, and. He knew the Celestials would come back and judge humanity. And if they turned thumbs down, it was bye-bye Earth. Mm-hmm. So really, he was saving us all.
Thank you.
We have to thank him. And the way he was doing that was getting people to kill each other. Mm-hmm. So that the weak would die off and the strong would survive and reproduce and turn into, you know, smarter, better, stronger, hopefully mutants.
Yeah.
So that's what his motivation was. And it just seemed like the sort of thing, it just seemed like a good idea at the time.
That was one of those ideas.
Yes, it was. And it was, again, an idea that just came to me like it was fully there. I mean, I didn't, at that point, I didn't know about the Celestials, but I knew that he was immortal. He had seen the future. And that he had to save the world, and this was how he was going to do it. So, I mean, the idea of the Celestials and all of that came a little bit later. But, yeah, so that's what he did. He was like, you know, he would shapeshift into somebody like Hitler and, you know, be a bad guy or whatever, you know, and, you know, all throughout history. A lot of the really nasty stuff that happened to people over history was Apocalypse's fault.
Yeah.
He was just trying to help us make it better.
I'm just trying to help. Now, while you didn't create Angel, You did give him the metal wings and the blue skin, the whole Archangel.
Right.
So how did that, why did you decide to do that?
Several of the X-Factor guys had 1960s powers in a 1980s universe. And when I had wanted to, and then when Walter came out, it became even more interesting to take each of the characters who was less powerful, less dominant, and give them, you know, up their powers.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, you know, we did it in several ways. For Archangel, Apocalypse seemed the answer. And I think the most interesting. Apocalypse was going to, he created the Four Horsemen of mm-hmm. Apocalypse, you know, to rain death down upon Manhattan and see what would happen. And and he took Angel, who had his wings ripped off in Fall of the Mutants because we're evil. And It appeared that Angel had committed suicide in, I don't know, you know, despair over his loss of wings, but in actual fact, Apocalypse had taken him and transformed him into the character Death. And because he was Death, he would grow him wings. He would give him his heart's desire, which was wings, but they would be lethal wings. Nothing from Apocalypse comes without a price.
Yeah.
The wings were lethal. And, you know, when he ching, they would go from his back and ching, go out and then ching. And the blades, the feathers of the wings would fly off and they'd be darts and, you know, kill people and stuff. So, yeah. So we just thought it was kind of it was cool and different. Also, it was a change of character for him. He had always been this sunny, bright, rich character who didn't have any problems. He was like a little boring, I thought.
He was, just a little bit.
But he was pretty, but he was boring. it's characters are more interesting when you're torturing them and they're standing up to the torture. This is probably how Apocalypse feels. This is probably where Apocalypse came from. We tortured him into becoming, I think, a stronger, more interesting character.
Yeah.
Certainly his powers were more interesting. I mean, he before he could fly, what, 80 miles an hour, maybe? And yeah. Now he's can go fly at supersonic speeds with lethal wings. So anyway, so that's why we did that.
Okay. Real quick before questions disappear.
Oh, goodness.
Bradley Tan asked, what are your thoughts on Jonathan Hickman's run on the mutants and X-Men?
Oh, Lord, I've never read them. I usually don't read the work of people unless I have to, because there's been a crossover or there's something that I'm required to participate in and that I need to have the information. But if I don't usually read the work of people after I've gotten off a book, because I'll just sit there and criticize. I'll say, oh, that's not the right kind of dialogue. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, why would I put myself through that or them? Because it's really unfair.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
I didn't read it, but I'm sure it was wonderful.
All right. You can ask questions. So everybody, not you. Well, you can ask questions. If you can. here's Bob Harrison. Was it an editorial decision to D-wing Warren, or was that?
No, that was us. That was us being cruel and mean.
But that was kind of a theme that you did. And I tell you that
it was my apocalypsian moment. What
you were just trying to help him.
I was making him better.
But you would do that. You would take away his flight. You would take away like mean sense of self. You would take away the humor from people. You would take away leadership from Cyclops to make them stronger.
Right.
And I think that's something that goes through, but it also, it's the whole thing that I get from a lot of your writing is that it's empathy, it's hopeful, and that's what makes some comics don't age very well.
Mm-hmm.
Your comics, they age very well because
that's nice to hear. Thank you.
They do, because it's humanity. We still have these same things, you know. Mm-hmm. We still, when something horrible happens to us, we do want to make it does make us stronger if we can get over it.
Right.
We've all experienced that.
Yeah.
And so that's what you feel. And that's why they just age so well.
Well, that's a really interesting analysis. I never heard that before. And it's a very, actually a very nice analysis. I'll adopt it. Thank you.
You got it. I can't help it. I'm a little bit of a fan. So, you know.
Aww, it's sweet.
Cassis Brooke asked, was Mr. who has been making comments this whole time and adores your work. Was Mr. Power modeled on Mr. Simonson?
Well, that's how June drew him.
Okay.
June drew Walter. He drew me. I mean, June drew me as Mrs. Power.
Mm-hmm.
However, I didn't think that we could put my and Walter's name in as the Power parents. So I put in my sister and her husband in.
Oh.
This is Margaret. It's my youngest sister. Mm-hmm. And her husband is Jim. And, Jim actually looks a bit like Walter. I mean, he's got the beard and stuff. So, yeah, so it just seemed right.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. All right. We'll get, Robert Harrison. How did the Hyperbreed series with Storm Kids come about?
Okay, Guy Dorian, who drew the book, is really, really good at networking.
Mm-hmm.
And he was at a booth across from where I know Sandy and I like her. And we were over there talking, you know, having a good time just for fun. And he came over and from the booth, he was across the hall. PKM, I think, is the name of the company, and said and started saying, well, you know what, maybe Weezy and I can do a book together. Maybe we can do a science fiction book. And I said, well, yeah, sure, I'd love to do that. That would be fun. And Sandy said, okay, great, do it. And that was it. I mean, I did say to Sandy, maybe you should see what we want to do before you actually tell us yes. A proposal for it's an idea that I had a while back and just never gotten around to doing. It was an idea from back in the day when I loved. Oh God, what was the name of it? It was an Australian science fiction movie. I mean, a TV show with characters in space, of course. I can't remember the name of it now. Anyway, it was kind of inspired by just the fun of that particular series. You know, a guy from Earth gets kind of sucked into space with all this craft with all of his aliens, and they go around and they, you know, have exciting adventures. So I thought, well, you know, I wanted to feel like that. So so I wrote up this proposal, and Sandy loved it. So then we did it. That was how that happened.
There you go.
It was really because Guy walked across the aisle. Are you seeing a pattern here? It's like, it's all I owe my life to my friends.
Yeah. Well, yeah, possibly, but knowing the people can get you in, but staying is the talent. So
I guess, I suppose it does. I mean, everybody who works really hard and does a good job is going to get a break.
Yeah.
But when the break comes, you got to have the stuff.
Yes. You have to have it. Yeah.
And that takes a lot of work to get to the point where you're good enough that you're going to be, I don't know, that you're that people are going to want to hire you over somebody else.
Yes.
So, you know, so that's what we tell, Walter and I tell people that, you know, it's like you get the break, but then you've got to really have the stuff.
Yeah.
You have stuff by working really hard before you get the break. Yeah. And afterwards too.
And afterwards. We have another question, but before this doesn't get mentioned, I have to say one of my favorite moments in my life, and this, it's, I guess, whatever. Last year at Baltimore Comic-Con, where you had broken your foot, and everybody was afraid you weren't going to be there, and thankfully you were. You were presented an award.
I was.
The Humanitarian Award by Walter. And it was so sweet because I remember Mark Nathan coming over right before, you know, when he was giving the award, and you had no idea.
No idea. No,
I'm proud of Walter for keeping it a secret.
Oh, also, I mean, you can tell, I mean, I had a relatively decent top, but I had my DC hoodie thrown over it because the rooms get chilly, and I was wearing jeans, and I had this big old boot on. I had thought. That I, and we were at a table up front, but I had thought, you know, where people generally get awards, and I thought it was going to be like Greg Hildebrandt, because we were there with them. I mean, they were there also for the first time, and we were friends of theirs. So I thought we'd been put there to you know, make them more comfortable, and it just never occurred to me, ever. It was very funny.
There are pictures of you and Mark Nathan, you know, holding your hand right before, and when Walter says your name, it was one of those moments that it was so wonderful to experience, and you were just a delight, and so no one deserved it more than you, and I'm so glad that we all got to share that moment.
I'm glad. You know, I began to think something was up when Mark came over and held my hand. Like, oh dear, what's going on?
You wanted to make sure you could speak.
Walter got up to talk. It never occurred to me, because I thought, well, you know, he probably mentioned to me that was going to introduce somebody, and I just wasn't paying attention. You know,
oh yeah.
So, so it was really sweet of Mark. I mean, I don't see myself as a humanitarian at all. I see myself as a very lucky human being. So, it was kind of a shock there too. You know, I thought there's so many people who really deserve that award more than I do. So it was really quite a shock and sweet that I was given it.
Well, from the outside looking at you, no one deserved it more. So
that's so sweet. Thank you. That was nice of you to say.
So now we can have some more questions, but I just wanted to, that moment was, I mean, I was bawling. It was ridiculous.
Oh God. Really?
So excited. And I knew what was going on. So it's just like, and it still got me.
Yeah.
Brad Tree says, what recollections can you share of your involvement with X-Men Titans, an incredible crossover?
It was an excellent crossover. It was, I guess, Marvel's turn. You know, I don't know why, I guess it must have been Marvel's turn to do a crossover. And we had the X-Men on one side, which I was editing, and we had, and they had the Teen Titans, which was a really good book. Mm-hmm. It was really, really well done. So I guess it just seemed natural to put these two together. I don't think I was the person who suggested that, although, you know, it's the sort of thing that I could have suggested. It was a great idea. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was Marvel's turn to actually produce the crossover. And of course, Chris would write it. And, you know, we were looking, I guess we were kind of discussing an artist. And Walter was in the, we were married at that point, I think. Yes, we were. And so Walter's there in the office for some reason, and he walks past my office as Chris and I are talking about the characters who would appear and what villains would appear. Mm-hmm. Because there was a discussion, I guess, about, you know, keeping the balance of villains in the book. You know, if you've got an X-Men villain, you've got to have a DC villain. Mm-hmm. We were talking about Dark Phoenix, and it was like our Phoenix, who was not really, she had been, Jean had been, oh, I don't know, Dark Phoenixified, I guess, at that point.
Dark Phoenixified.
But we thought we could actually kind of use the image anyway, which was cool. And what DC villain, Trigon at that point was their major bad guy. Mm-hmm. And we hadn't seen enough of him to appreciate him. Who we really wanted to use, we wondered if they would let us use Darkseid. And Walter walks by saying Darkseid, he says, I don't know what you guys are talking about, but if it's Darkseid, I want to draw him. Okay, well, we'll propose you then as the artist. That sounds good. So we talked to DC about it, and we did express that we weren't wild about using Trigon as the opposite villain. Mm-hmm. But I think maybe it was Lynn or Marv, one of them suggested that if we could do, oh dear, what was his name? I can't remember now. Sort of an assassin kind of character they had, that we could use Darkseid. It would mean that they would get two villains and we would have one.
Okay.
We were cool with that. Because that meant we got Walter. And, you know, that'll work out. And you know, so Chris wrote a really, really good story. And Walter drew a really, really nice book. And Terry did a wonderful job inking it, Terry Austin. Mm-hmm. We have on our wall downstairs the double page splash, or double of spread rather, of the X-Men and Titans with Changeling, who was called Changeling instead of Beast Boy at the time, flying over the city as a dragon with them all holding on to him. And this fabulous shot of the city below that honestly, Walter gives Terry all the credit for. He said he put in these, you know, the buildings. Terry put on all the windows and all the, you know, curly cues and furbelows, and it was it's a really, really nice piece. It was a beautifully done crossover, and I was very proud to be associated with it. You know, we were very, very lucky in all of our interactions, which were all very friendly. You know, later on there was some animosity between Marvel and DC and involving crossovers, but we didn't get any of that at all. It was a pleasurable experience from beginning to end.
And it shows.
Everyone being very cooperative.
It was great. Yeah. I want to show one more thing. You co-created this guy too.
Oh, Cable. Oh, yeah. Hi, Cable.
That guy. You know, maybe you'll be, you know, popular someday. How did that, I mean, what was your thought process on that? Okay.
At that point, in the New Mutants, they were pretty much on their own. They had Xavier was gone. They had a mentor, but he was Magneto, and they didn't trust him as far as they could throw him.
Okay.
So you know, they were really kind of operating independently of him. And Bob Harris thought they needed a grown-up in charge. I didn't want a character like Professor X, who spent a lot of time worrying about the, you know, whether his little charges, you know, particularly the young ones, would get hurt. I wanted somebody who would use them like cannon fodder, like warriors, because he had come from a place where he had come from the future. He knew, obviously, I'm not expecting good things in the future, where he knew bad things were going to happen and that, you know, people were going to have to be tough. And maybe if they're tough enough and strong enough, they can change the world so this particular future doesn't come to pass. So that he would use them as warriors. So that was what I wanted to do with Cable. Rob Liefeld was drawing the book at the time. He had sent in a batch of character sheets that had a lot of different villains on them, a lot of different drawings on them, mm-hmm. of different characters. And the ones that Bob and I both liked the best was his drawing of the fellow who had become Cable. I think originally he was supposed to be a villain character. And that's what I'm remembering anyway. But we really liked the look of him for the leader of the group, so we said whatever. And I kind of vaguely remember that his name was Strife at the time, but I could be wrong about that. You know, it's been a very long time now. God, it's been a really long time. I don't want to think about it. It's a miracle I remember any of this. So you know, we said okay, him, and I had been using as a placeholder name in a plot, Commander X, because it was not a name I was intending. I'd like to know what a character looks like before I name them.
Yeah.
And Rob said, no, he has to be called Cable. It's really, really important to him that he be called Cable. I said, sure, Cable's fine. So, you know, it's like any name is fine once you get to know the person.
Yeah.
You know, you can think, you know, somebody can have a name that you think is a little peculiar, and then you get to know them, and then that name becomes them.
Yes. Yes.
And fine. So sometimes I'm picky about the names and sometimes of characters, and this one was, Rob was picky about that. That was fine. So you know, that's how Cable was created. We said, okay, that guy. And then I just, you know, wrote the character that I had intended. He looks, the big gun and the big whatever, big shoulders and stuff. He looks like the kind of guy who would, use kids as warriors.
Oh yeah, he certainly does. We do have another question from Eternatine Forever.
Eternatine.
What would you do with Power Pack as adults if you could?
I don't think I would. I want Power Pack to stay kids. I know there are other people who've grown them up a little bit. I did a story recently, and I'm now working on a mini series, which Alex has just turned 13.
Okay.
So he's a teenager now. I probably, if it's up to me, he'll be a teenager for 10 years or longer than, oh, wow, longer than, in the next 30 or 40 years. We'll all be dead by the time he gets to be out of his teens. Because I think one of the things that makes them unique is that they are kids.
Yes.
It might be, I don't want to do this, but it might be interesting to have them grown up and have children of their own who've inherited the powers in this modern world. I think that would be an interesting thing to do eventually for somebody. But, you know, honestly, this is, you know, why, you know, talking about books that were an inspiration when we were kids, I read the books, the Half Magic books by a writer whose name was Edward Eger. And he did that. He had the Half Magic kids in one book and they had adventures and they grew up and their children had adventures in Knight's Castle and I think the Time Garden, a batch of other books.
Mm-hmm.
So, because the Half Magic took place in the 20s. And then the 50s is where the modern books took place. So I probably just copycatting somebody. But that's something I would do because I think that would be interesting to see if the kids inherited their parents' powers or some of their parents' powers, and how these super parent powered parents would then deal with having superpowered children. Yeah. Would be kind of fun.
That would be fun. That would be fun.
Maybe a movie of that one already. Disney did that, didn't he? Impossibles, whatever they were, Improbables. I can't remember the name of the movie now.
Oh my gosh, it just has escaped.
It doesn't matter. They all know what we're talking about.
Incredibles. The Great Legend Show asks, what was it like sharing the cover with Swamp Thing on House of Secrets issue 92?
You mean sharing the cover with Swamp Thing?
Yeah, with Swamp Thing on this issue. What was it like sharing the
cover? It wasn't exactly that Swamp Thing wasn't really coming through the
Wait, door. What?
But it was really fun.
It was fun to
put on a costume and act out a story.
Yeah.
And that was really what we were doing. And it was kind of interesting to see how the different artists, because we were all of the artists, I say we, but I was not an artist. I was a beautiful female assistant, got to see what they did with the use of reference. I mean, it was at that point reference became really, it became clear to the young artists that, and they were all very young. I mean, you know, in our early 20s, I think Bernie might not have even been 20 yet. He was very young. He was very young when he started. He came by our apartment when he was 17 years old and showed us Uncle Bill's Barrel. And we knew at that point that he was a genius, that it was just a matter of time before he took off. So, you know, he was a prodigy. I've known several prodigy artists in my time, and he was one of them. But it was, his universe was so inside, so interior, that he really didn't seem to need reference in the way that a lot of people seem to require it to really make their work look better. But I mean, it was interesting seeing what he did with it when he had reference. So, you know, I was just a body. I was a model, an actor in this little short comic book plays.
He once told me all I did was pretend to brush my hair. And
yes, that was it. Yes.
Oh my gosh, we're almost out of time and we haven't even, I told you we weren't going to get through it because
that's all right.
You're so brilliant.
At the high points.
Talked about the death of Superman or the wedding album or Warlock. We haven't talked about any of that or the amazing young adult novels that you've done. So what can we look forward to? We'll wrap up. What can we look forward to coming from you?
Okay, I'm working on a Power Pack mini series right now. And it follows the single issue I did where Alex's birthday party when he turns 13. It spins off of that, but I don't know how much more I'm allowed to say other than it exists because comic books these days. I'm doing several issues of X Factor that will fit into the old continuity. My old continuity was really tight. There's not a lot of room to slip things in. Mm-hmm. But it was between issue, I guess it was like, was it between 141 and 142, where, you know, X Factor are on Earth and then they're on ship out of the ocean. The ship takes off for outer space. Mm-hmm. So it's right in there. There's a little bit of flexible time that we were able to do. So it's a story that fits in there.
Oh, that's exciting.
So that's what I'm doing. I may be doing a book for somebody that I'm not allowed to talk about yet either. But and I have an idea for another kids series.
Oh, good.
That I may pitch to Sandy over at Storm King. You know, we'll see if it's anything she'd be interested in because she has that kids line now.
Yes.
My science fiction story got slotted into the kids line, I think, because there was no sex or a lot of violence. It was very violent, but I guess it's comic book violence.
Yeah.
Blood splashes around, but you know, whatever, it's in space, it floats like globules. So So I'll see if she's interested in publishing this other thing. So that's about probably about as much stuff as I can do, you know, in the next year and actually do it properly.
Oh, well, it'll all be brilliant and I cannot wait.
Oh, that's sweet of you to say.
I just can't. I have so many fans at my store. They gush over you.
I'm fans of theirs too. I have to say, I have the nicest fans in the whole world. My Power Pack fans particularly are so lovable.
Yes.
But I know all of them. I know they're just, we have, Walter and I both think that we have the best fans ever. They're just mostly kind, nice, good people.
Well, you know, because they're fans, because you are nice, kind, good people.
That's sweet.
You and Walter are two of my favorite people in the world, so.
Well, you're on our favorites list too, so there you go.
Thank you. I hate to wrap this up because I just want to keep catching up with you, which is what I feel like I'm doing. Which is,
I know, it's part of the fun, isn't it?
Yes. But thank you so much for coming on here and being a part of the Baltimore Comic-Con live, since we can't be there in person. And soon, we're going to get our vaccines, catch up, and then...
I know. Yay, vaccines. And everyone vote. That's the thing.
Yes, vote. Exactly. Well, thank you so much, Louise. And everybody, thank you for joining us. And stay tuned. I think Jeff Parker's next, who also is super awesome. So thank you so much, Louise. You take care, and we'll talk soon.
You too. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye, everybody. Thank you.